saying I'm going to be going over the emerging Eurasian alliance as an opportunity, not a threat. And part of it will be going over our relationship with Russia and China from World War I and World War II, but also the lost chance of 1989. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll explain myself in a short while. So the Berlin Wall was built in 1961, and it stretched out 140 kilometers. It eventually became two walls thick and was a height of 11.8 feet. For the most part, it was electrified. It consisted of 116 watchtowers, and it was equipped with numerous alarm systems and watched over by some 14,000 guards and dogs. The wall separated families, and several hundred people died trying to cross this wall into the west. It divided Berlin for 28 years. So just to make it clear, actually, I do need the pen. Okay. So this is West Berlin, and the wall went all the way around West Berlin. And if you look at it, that's Berlin, in the middle of all this Soviet territory. So Germany was split up. It was split up already after World War I, where some of the European countries had taken certain sections of Germany, which was its industrial core. And on top of that, it had asked Germany to pay these heavy reparations, which predictably collapsed its economy and allowed the ushering in of fascism, which interestingly was not as natural of an occurrence as people think nowadays, but was actually funded, had Western funding, Hitler, namely by the Bank of International Settlements, J.P. Morgan, Brown Brothers Harriman, the Bank of England, to name a few. So it's interesting to think about that after World War I, they did this to Germany, and obviously to sponsor someone like Hitler pretty much means that you want another war. And so, predictably, another war occurred, World War II, and Germany lost again, and it was punished once again. And the decision was, from 1945 until 1949, Britain would have this, US, France, anyway, and then the Soviet power here. And then after 1949, basically all the Western side agreed that they were going to make this the Federal Republic of Germany, and the Soviets in 1949 had their section, the German Democratic Republic. So of course the question asked would be, why was it split up this way? Why didn't they just allow Germany to unite? Well, I'll answer that in a little while. So this is a picture of LB Day. It's April 25th, 1945, and this was when World War II was sort of considered done, even though officially it was in September. This is when the American soldiers and the Russian soldiers met for the first time, Americans from the West and the Soviets from the East into Germany. And they saw each other after years of both combating fascism. And it was a very important day. As you can see, they'd never met these people before, but they were like brothers. It's also important to note that up until this point, the Americans and the Russians actually never really had any problems with each other. There's nothing in their history up until that point that would have caused any kind of conflict. And actually, the Russians had been very instrumental in supporting the Americans during the Civil War, where they had their navy docked on the east and west coasts of the United States in support of Lincoln's Union and in defense of any foreign intervention, namely Britain or France, to come in. So they basically stayed there for 7 months. They didn't interact with the war, but they basically told Britain and France that they would engage in war with them if they intervened, because Britain and France were for the Confederacy being considered independent. So they've been actually brothers in arms for a while, most of their history. This is an account of the number of deaths after World War II. And for those who don't know, the Soviets by far outnumber anyone else, although the Chinese are a close second. And I'll explain to you why there's so many civilian deaths for the Chinese as well. But there's about 24 million Soviet civilians who died and about 11 million soldiers. They were absolutely instrumental in defeating Hitler as quickly as he was defeated. And the Chinese played, of course, a huge role against the Japanese. President Roosevelt, who enabled a dialogue between the US, Russia, and Britain, passed away April 12, 1945. World War II officially ended months later, September 2nd. Quickly after the death of FDR, Russia was no longer considered an ally of the West. Upon the cuff of defeating fascism, and with German industry and people and the German people splintered, it was soon after announced that Russia would be chosen as the world's next primary enemy. It was announced by Winston Churchill on March 5, 1946, in his Iron Curtain speech, that the country that led to the defeat of fascism, Russia, was now considered a threat to democracy across the world. So to revisit this picture here, Churchill's speech was in 1946, and the choosing of how they were going to split Germany up into the two different republics was done in 49. So you can't blame the Soviets for not, you know, including their section in with everyone else, because they had already been named an enemy by 1946. So it was the West who caused that split. It's not to advocate the Berlin Wall or anything, but at the same time, the Soviets were really put in a difficult situation. China also played a pivotal role in winning both World War I and World War II. China's hope was if they played a role in World War I, they could hopefully get an equal seat at the table, so to speak, especially because there were problems with inequality between China and Japan's relationship, Japan being obviously favored by the West. China very much wanted to enter World War I as a military support, but it was decided that all the Allied countries had to give their okay as to whether China would be allowed to do this, and Japan denied China entering the war as soldiers, which demoted their status in the World War. Because they were denied this, the Chinese actually didn't stop there, and they offered a labor support, which became actually the biggest non-European labor support during World War I, and it was largely kept a secret. Even a year into this, it was largely denied diplomatically that China was playing any role. And yet, China continued. By 1915, this is in the course of World War I, Japan took the Qingdao, did I say it right? Qingdao from Germany, and Japan imposed a new treaty on China, the 21 Demands. The highly unpopular treaty required China to cede control of even more territory, including in Shandong and Manchuria. If China thought if they participated in World War I, like continued, its leaders reasoned that maybe the country could win back these territories from Japan. So by the end of the war, China was by far the largest non-European labor force and played an incredibly significant role in supporting World War I in their arms manufacturers, their repair, all of this sort of stuff. But by the end of the war, the Treaty of Versailles concluded that China should succumb to the demands of Japan and forfeit these territories, despite everything that they did. This was considered, obviously, a huge blow to the Chinese, a huge humiliation, and they refused to sign the Treaty of Versailles. It's also important to know that Shandong is a very sacred territory for the Chinese. It's not only Confucius's hometown, and Taoism also played a huge role in there, but find it here. It's also the ancient home state of Qi, the last kingdom conquered by Qin Shi Huang, who proclaimed himself China's first emperor in 219 BC. So despite this, China fought also in World War II. Despite the betrayal after World War I, they fought in World War II as soldiers because Japanese had now become the Nazis. China was betrayed by Western Europe, but it still offered its support to the Allies in the necessity to combat fascism. China was therefore more loyal to the security of Europe despite this betrayal than the Japanese, who received recompense for their role in World War I only to turn against Europe in World War II. So to revisit this number of deaths of civilian Chinese people, this was because of the Japanese Nazi massacre. One of the largest, well, the most notorious ones is the Nanking Massacre, which is known for one of the worst genocides, not just for the number of people killed, but the level of torture that occurred during this time. There was mass rape as well. They had mass graves that they dug, and they, to save time, would ask Chinese people to stand in there so that they could be shot and save time for carrying them. They would ask Chinese people to line up in a row so that one bullet could get rid of three or more people, and you would save your ammunition that way. So the Holocaust, it's widely recognized as one of the worst atrocities that was committed in the 20th century, but you never really hear about what happened to the Chinese, which is also, I would say, equally brutal. And it wasn't just the Chinese who suffered under the Japanese Nazis. It was all along the eastern coastline of Asia. Eastern. Okay, so let us return our story back to the Berlin Wall, keeping all of this baggage of history in mind so that we're not stuck in just encapsulating these times as if there's nothing behind it that's running the show. The Berlin Wall was up, just to remind everyone, from 1961 and 1989. So by 1989, the Soviets agreed to tear down the wall. This was an incredibly optimistic time for not only the German people, who would be reunited with their loved ones after 28 years of separation, but an incredibly optimistic time in the world as well. The fall of the Berlin Wall marked the nearing end of the Cold War era. That Churchill's Iron Curtain era was over, and the world could once again return to the hope that an era of peace and stability could finally come into being. It's important to note that part of the agreement to the Soviets tearing down the wall was the assurance from the West, because this was a big reason why the wall was up, an assurance from the West that they would not pursue an expansion of their military bases towards Russia, namely under NATO. Despite the Soviet Union following the parameters they were given, NATO has indeed expanded its presence into Eastern Europe, very near to the Russian border. This was the lost chance of 1989. The Russians were thus betrayed a second time. Despite this, there is a clear intention. To remind everyone, the first time was when they helped win World War I and World War II. Only a year later, less than a year after World War II, they would be named by Churchill as the number one enemy in the world. So despite this, the Russians still, under the clear intention by President Putin, that such an agreement to back down the military still must occur, because there is no other option that does not risk an all-out Third World War. President Putin also makes the point that a unipolar world today cannot function, has not functioned, and has ultimately failed. It is time to accept the reality of a multipolar world. I'm just going to go over a few parts of President Putin made a very historical speech in 2007 at the Munich Security Conference, and I want to read a little bit of this. This universal, indivisible character of security is expressed as the basic principle that security for one is security for all. As Franklin D. Roosevelt said during the first few days that the Second World War was breaking out, when peace has been broken anywhere, the peace of all countries everywhere is in danger. Only two decades ago, the world was ideologically and economically divided, and it was the huge strategic potential of two superpowers that ensured global security. This global standoff pushed the sharpest economic and social problems to the margins of the international communities and the world's agenda. And just like any war, the Cold War left us with live ammunition, figuratively speaking. I am referring to ideological stereotypes, double standards, and other typical aspects of Cold War bloc thinking. The unipolar world that had been proposed after the Cold War did not take place either. The history of humanity certainly has gone through unipolar periods and seen aspirations to world supremacy, but what hasn't happened in world history? However, what is a unipolar world? However one might embellish this term, at the end of the day, it refers to one type of situation, namely one center of authority, one center of force, one center of decision making. It is a world in which there is one master, one sovereign, and at the end of the day, this is pernicious not only for all those within the system, but also for the sovereign itself, because it destroys itself from within. And this certainly has nothing in common with democracy, because as you know, democracy is the power of the majority in light of the interests and opinions of the minority. Incidentally, Russia, we are constantly being taught about democracy, but for some reason, those who teach us do not want to learn themselves. I consider that the unipolar model is not only unacceptable, but also impossible in today's world. And this is not only because if there was an individual leadership in today's, precisely in today's world, then the military, political, and economic resources would not suffice. What is even more important is that the model itself is flawed because at its basis there is and can be no moral foundation for modern civilization. Along with this, what is happening in today's world, and we just started to discuss this, is a tentative to introduce precisely this concept into international affairs, the concept of a unipolar world, and with which results. Unilateral and frequently illegitimate actions have not resolved any problems. Moreover, they have caused new human tragedies and created new centers of tension. Judge for yourselves, wars as well as local and regional conflicts have not diminished. One state, and of course the first and foremost, the United States, has overstepped its national borders in every way. This is visible in the economic, political, cultural, and educational policies it imposes on other nations. Well, who likes this? Who is happy about this? In international relations, we increasingly see the desire to resolve a given question according to the so-called issues of political expediency based on the current political climate. And of course, this is extremely dangerous. It results in the fact that no one feels safe. I want to emphasize this, no one feels safe, because no one can feel that international law is like a stone wall that will protect them. Of course, such a policy stimulates an arms race. The combined GDP, he basically says the combined GDP of Brazil, Russia, India, and so forth have now become cumulative to that of EU. So there is no reason to doubt that the economic potential of the new centers of global economic growth will inevitably be converted into political influence and will strengthen multipolarity. In connection with this, the role of multilateral diplomacy is significantly increasing. The need for principles such as openness, transparency, and predictability in politics is uncontested, and the use of force should be a really exceptional measure, comparable to using the death penalty in the judicial systems of certain states. I think it is obvious that NATO expansion does not have any relation with the modernization of the alliance itself or with ensuring security in Europe. On the contrary, it represents a serious provocation that reduces the level of mutual trust. And we have the right to ask, against whom is this expansion intended? Last slide from his speech. I would like to quote the speech of NATO General Secretary Mr. Werner in Brussels on 17th of May 1990. He said at the time that the fact that we are ready not to place a NATO army outside of German territory gives the Soviet Union a firm security guarantee. Where are these guarantees? The stones and concrete blocks of the Berlin Wall have long been distributed as souvenirs, but we should not forget that the fall of the Berlin Wall was possible thanks to a historic choice, one that was also made by our people, the people of Russia, a choice in favor of democracy, freedom, openness, and a sincere partnership with all the members of the big European family. And now they are trying to impose new dividing lines and walls on us, Russians. These walls may be virtual, but they are nevertheless dividing, ones that cut through our continent. And is it possible that we will once again require many years and decades, as well as several generations of politicians to dissemble and dismantle these new walls? The increasing social tension in depressed regions inevitably results in the growth of radicalism, extremism, feeds terrorism and local conflicts. And if all this happens in, shall we say, a region such as the Middle East, where there is increasingly the sense that the world at large is unfair, then there is the risk of global destabilization. Remember, he said this in 2007, before the whole Syrian situation. So it's pretty clear, I think, going through this history, that Russia and China wanted very much to cooperate with the West, and they were denied this. And they were given no choice but to ensure and look out for the survival of themselves. So that it's no surprise that Russia and China are very close today. However, they still are saying we're not a threat, but we should work together. So with the fall of the Berlin Wall, this hope and optimism that was displayed, it was best represented, because Germany has a very beautiful culture, despite all of the hardships of the 20th century. And they celebrated the fall of the Berlin Wall with the Ode to Joy, which Schiller originally wanted it to be called Ode to Freedom, but believe it or not, it was too controversial at the time. So he called it Ode to Joy. And Ludwig von Beethoven wrote the Ninth Symphony off of this, and it was the last symphony Beethoven ever composed. He really viewed this as like the culmination of everything he was working towards. So Leonard Bernstein was the conductor for this free concert, and he rightfully said it would be Ode to Freedom for that day. So I think what we'll do, I'm going to play you a part of this concert. And Schiller's poem, and that's what Beethoven was also doing, is Schiller's poem is about the conflict between man through history, tension, resolution, but ultimately towards the age of reason. And by the end of the piece, mankind or humankind has finally reached this age of reason.
A celebration of freedom. Under the leadership of the conductor Leonard Bernstein, orchestral players and choirs from both East and West Germany are joined here in Berlin, just a few hundred meters east of the Brandenburg Gate, by musicians from America, Russia, France, and Great Britain, the four countries who still have a formal presence in this no longer divided city. The concert is being televised in over 20 countries, from Japan in the east to America in the west. The wall is down, and the city is euphoric. And never was a musical work more suitable for a celebration than the one we shall hear now, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. Its grand design is crowned by a setting of Schiller's Ode to Joy, a poem which sings exultantly of the brotherhood of men. Aller Menschen werden Brüder. And this is the message we send from Berlin this Christmas. For this performance, in which unusually the adult choirs are joined by children's voices, Leonard Bernstein feels authorized by the power of the moment, as he puts it, to make a significant change in the poem. Instead of the word Freude, joy, the choir will each time sing Freiheit, freedom. And so this becomes, in word as well as deed, the Berlin Freedom Concert. A statue of Schiller stands outside the Schauspiel,
which was once the city's principal theatre. It was completely destroyed in the war, but has been restored to become one of the world's finest concert halls.
So this is going to be one of the conflict parts that we're going to listen to.
Thank you.
So that was the first part of which spoke. There's always a dialogue, even like the different instruments, they're all kind of like saying something different, and there's always like an argument that builds up, and so forth. But by the end of the piece, there starts to be a resolution, and I'm not taking up too much time. You want to be the German voice?
You want me to say the German voice? Yeah.
So the part of the chorus, now the part of freedom, I'm gonna just play you a short clip of that as well. These are the German the translation of the words that they're saying.
Freude, schön.
Oh, freedom.
Huh?
Freedom.
Freiheit. Freiheit, schöne Götterfunken, Tochter aus Elysium.
So freedom, beautiful spark of gods, daughter of Elysium.
Wir betreten feuertrunken himmlische dein Heiligtum.
We enter fire imbibed heavenly thy sanctuary.
Deine Zauber binden wieder, was der Mutter Schwert geteilt.
Thy magic powers reunite what custom's sword has divided.
Bettler werden Feuerstenbrüder, wo dein sanfter Flügel weilt.
Beggars become princeless brothers, where thy gentle wing abides.
Seidung schlungen Millionen, diesen Kuss der ganzen Welt.
Be embraced millions, this kiss to the entire world.
Brüder über Sternenzelt, müß ein lieber Vater wohnen.
Brothers, above the starry canopy, a loving father must dwell.
That's not the whole poem, though. That's a part of it, right?
Yeah, this is only a part of it. It's about an hour and a half, so even though it might seem like I'm playing a lot, I'm not. All right.
Thank you.
That might have seemed painfully long for some, but I think it does the soul good to hear it. And it's very, you know, it's important. I find that in today's world, we kind of like get a little bit jaded when we talk about hope for an age that could be governed by reason. And when you see people uniting this way, because Beethoven is the ultimate peaceful revolutionary, it really brings hope. It really is a powerful thing, and we should really let that sink in. An interesting note to make is that the Chinese also played a Beethoven piece. It was Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. I believe it was Beethoven's 150th anniversary. And they played this piece as a celebration for the end of the Cultural Revolution, where China went through a period where they were banned Western classical arts. So it's a universally recognized thing. Beethoven definitely represents, I think, spiritual freedom for us, which is what we want in this age of reason that I think we are capable of. So just to wrap it up, I think that, you know, it's time that we, the West, recognize our faults and hypocrisy. The Western hegemony over the world is coming to an end, and we should be happy for our brothers and sisters who have a renewed hope for a better life, largely from the New Silk Road. We have no place to condemn their rise as a threat to Western stability. We are the ones guilty of breaching trust time after time. We need to correct this monstrous inability to trust and love those outside the Western sphere. These cultures, some which may have been considered by us backwards not that long ago, have grown and cultivated themselves in nobility, such that we today look very small next to them. We have become the backwards culture. We have become the barbaric culture that only knows war and is a disbeliever in peace. We who are privileged enough to have never experienced war in our homelands for almost a century are the ones who condone it as necessary on others. What an ugly, ugly belief this is. It is time the West, and very much so its people, because it will need to come from the people first. It is time the West has the humility to admit that it has forgotten what once made them a great and noble people. We need to rediscover these principles in ourselves and our countries. We need to have the humility to admit that we have something to learn from the rest of the world. Only then can there be a true dialogue amongst civilizations towards the common goal of peace. And it is through artists such as Schiller and Beethoven that we can educate ourselves such that we can enter finally an age that is governed by reason. Thank you.